بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين نبينا وحبيبنا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. أما بعد، يقول المؤلف رحمه الله تعالى: ولا تصح خلف تارك ركن. So last time he said لا تصح الصلاة خلف من صلاته فاسدة إلا لمن لم يعلم بحدث نفسه. A prayer of somebody whose prayer is batila is invalid also. إذا بطل الأصل بطل كل ما يبنى عليه. If the root is gone, whatsoever is built upon it will be gone also. So that person, his prayer is batil. Therefore, if I pray behind him, my prayer also should be batil. He said, إِلَّا لِمَنْ لَمْ يَعْلَمْ بِحَدَثِ نَفْسِهِ, except in the case of somebody who doesn't know that he is in a state of hadath. وَلَمْ يَعْلَمْهُ الْمَأْمُومُ حَتَّى سَلَّمَ, and the ma'moom did not know until the end of the prayer. Then the prayer of the ma'moom is okay. But the prayer of the imam is not okay. Whenever he remembers, he has to pray again. وَلَا تَصِحُّ خَلْفَ تَارِكِ رُكْنٍ. He said, حتى سلم فإنه يعيد وحده. So the imam is going to repeat the prayer alone. So this one we did it last class. قال ولا تصح خلف تارك ركن. And also the prayer of somebody who prays behind a person who leaves the rukn. So prayer has arkan, shurut, wajibat, sunan. The one who prays and he leaves a rukn, he doesn't pray the rukun. If I pray behind him, my prayer also is batil, just like the way his is batil. And all this is because of the qaida al-amma that says, إِذَا بَطَلَ الْأَصْلُ بَطَلَ كُلُّ مَا يُبْنَى عَلَيْهِ. This is a very excellent general principle, legal maxim. إِذَا بَطَلَ الْأَصْلُ بَطَلَ كُلُّ مَا يُبْنَى عَلَيْهِ. You get it? This one has exceptions. And this exception, I will give it to you as an assignment to see whether you can find it or not. إِذَا سَقَطَ الْأَصْلُ سَقَطَ الْفَرْعُ. But the scholar said, there are certain occasions whereby the asl is batil and the far is still in existence. You get it? And this is so strange, because when you have the root, you cut it off, the branches also will be gone. But they say we have few cases in fiqh of Islam whereby the asl is gone, but the branches, some of the branches are still in existence. Shaykh Abu Bakr al-Ahdal says in his manzuma fi qawaid al-fiqhiyya, وَرُبَّمَا يَسْقُطُ حُكْمُ الْأَصْلِ وَرُبَّمَا يَثْبُتُ حُكْمُ الْفَرْعِ وَالْأَصْلُ غَيْرُ ثَابِتٍ فِي الشَّرْعِ وَرُبَّمَا يَثْبُتُ حُكْمُ الْفَرْعِ وَالْأَصْلُ غَيْرُ ثَابِتٍ فِي الشَّرْعِ. He says sometimes you will see the hukum of the far', which is the branch, will be established while the asl is gone. So the assignment is, please get for me at least two examples of a place where the asl is gone and the far' is still in existence. I have a book for somebody who got it. Bizin light up, inshallah. So this is one of the reasons why he says, if you pray behind somebody whose prayer is batil, your prayer also is batil. You pray behind somebody who leaves the rukun, what will happen to your prayer? His prayer is batil, and therefore yours also is batil. Is that clear? قَالَ وَلَا تَصِحُّ خَلْفَ تَارِكُ رُكْنٍ إِلَّا إِمَامُ الْحَيِّ إِذَا صَلَّى جَالِسًا لِمَرَضٍ يُرْجَى بُرْءُهُ فَإِنَّهُمْ يُسَلُّونَ وَرَاءَهُ جُلُوسًا. قَالَ إِلَّا إِمَامُ الْحَيِّ, except in the case of إِمَامُ الْحَيِّ. So لاحظوا هنا, he did not say إِلَّا الْإِمَامُ, he said إِمَامُ الْحَيِّ. the Imam of the community. It means the Ratib Imam. Let's say in this Nottingham, you have an Imam in the Masjid who is the real Imam you have, the Ratib, the one who prays خمس صلوات with you guys. Get it? So this Imam al-Hayy قال لا تصح الصلاة خلف من ترك ركنا خلف تاركي ركنا except behind Imam al-Hayy that leaves what? Rukun. If I'm not the Imam here, if I leave a Rukun, if you pray behind me, your prayer also is gone. Unless if I have excuse. But the Shaykh said, this exception is only given to the Imam of Al-Hayy. Who is the Imam Al-Hayy? The Imam Al-Ratib. إِذَا صَلَّى جَالِسًا لِمَرَضٍ. One of the arkan of the prayer is Qiyam. Okay. خلاص عايزين ربما رجع الى البناء. قال الا امام الحي اذا صلى جالسا لمرض يرجى برؤه. Except in the case of Imam al-Hayy when he prays jalis. I mean qiyam in the prayer is rukun, right? I have to stand up when I pray. He said except for the Imam al-Hayy when he prays jalisan. لمرض يرجى برؤه because of the illness which we have a hope that he is going to be healed, he's going to be okay in the future. You have two types of amrad. That is مرض الذي لا يرجى برؤه, those a type of illness which you will lose hope that this person is going to be okay in the future. So he said, إِلَّا إِمَامُ الْحَيِّ إِذَا صَلَّى جَالِسًا لِمَرَضٍ يُرْجَى بُرْءُهُ. Except in the case of Imam al-Hayy, when he prays seated because of the illness that we have a big hope that he's going to be okay in the future. فَإِنَّهُمْ يُصَلُّونَ وَرَاءَهُ جُلُوسًا. In this case, they are supposed to pray behind him جُلُوسًا. This is a controversial issue among the scholars. When the Imam prays Jalis, how should we pray? Shall we just pray behind him julus, or we have to pray behind him standing? Because the problems is only in him, it's not in us. Is that clear? So he says, that's a controversial issue. Shall we just pray behind the Imam julus, or we have to pray standing? Because the problem is with the Imam. Okay. When is it possible for me to pray without observing the arkan? When I am not capable of doing that, right? In the hadith of Imran ibn Husayn, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam لما شكى بواسير قال له صل قائما فإن لم تستطع فقائدا فإن لم تستطع فعلى جنب. When he complained certain illness, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, pray standing. If you cannot pray standing, he said, sit down. If you cannot sit and pray, he said, lie down on your right side. If that one is not okay, the scholar said you go on your back. You get it? اتقوا الله ما استطعتم. So I have a problem. The excuse is only given to who? Ibrahim. But how about the people behind me? Do they have the same problem? No. That's the reason why the question was raised by the scholars. How should I pray behind Imam that is sick, who is not able to stand up in the prayer? He can only sit down. How should I pray? You have variety types of opinions among the scholars, but here the Hanabila, here they take which opinion according to Ibn Qudama, the one that says, if this Imam, there are some people who says, no, you pray behind him standing. So the Imam is seated and you are standing, right? Why? Because the problem is with the Imam. It doesn't affect you. You have to pray according to the Sunnah. You get it? They said you have to pray standing. And they have their own evidence also in this case. You get it? To prove what they said. There are some people who are moderated. What did they mention? They said, we look at the nature of the prayer. How does it begin first? And what was the end? How did the prayer begin? And what was the end? They said if the prayer was initiated while the Imam is standing and then the problem comes, because sometimes the Imam can tolerate praying standing, but then afterwards he will be affected by the illness and then he cannot, I mean, stand up anymore. He has to sit down. They said if the prayer was initiated by the Imam while the Imam was standing, and then the problem comes which forced the Imam to sit down, the Ma'moom behind him should continue their prayer standing. Do you get how they try to modify and be moderated? They say, we look at the prayer. How does it begin? If the Imam begins the prayer standing, we go standing. Even if the problem comes afterward, we will continue in the way we were before. But if the Imam already began the prayer seated, we will sit down and pray with him seated also. Is that clear? Wallahu alam, what was the evidence for this? The evidence for this is the practice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But it says the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam appointed Abu Bakr to pray. And while he was praying, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came out. Or the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was somewhere else, but then he came. You get it? And met the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and met Abu Bakr praying with the people. But the most closest, the one that says he came from the house because he was ill. And then when he opened the door, he moved, he crawled slowly until he reached Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. So what did he do? Abu Bakr already started prayer with the people. How was that? Standing, right? And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came. Now the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was praying with the people. Abu Bakr was going to go back. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was pointing to him, don't. He doesn't want to listen. He kept on going back. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam kept on telling him, makanak, stay where you are. So he refused. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam decided to just stand since he doesn't want, and the Prophet doesn't want him also to go back. So he stood at the left side of Abu Bakr to be what? The Imam. Because that was the only thing Abu Bakr can accept. So they prayed like that. After they finished the prayer, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ya Abu Bakr, what stops you from following my command when I tell you stay?" And look at the respect from the Prophet from Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. He said, "Ya Rasulullah, ma yanbaghi li ibn Abi Quhafa." Allahu Akbar. Even his name, he make it in that way. He did not say li Abi Bakr. He said li ibn Abi Quhafa. He said it is inappropriate for a son of Abu Quhafa to lead a prayer while the Prophet ﷺ is the Ma'moom. He said it's impossible. Allahu Akbar. The Prophet ﷺ praises him for that. But then the question is, how shall we practice the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ? And this is the reason why these scholars, they said, taking from this event into consideration, we will learn that if the prayer was initiated while the Imam is standing, and the later on the Imam became seated, we will continue our prayer standing. You get it? Because that prayer, Abu Bakr was imitating the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was praying with the people. Abu Bakr imitated the Prophet, and the people are imitating Abu Bakr. So in reality, they are imitating who? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. One prayer with two, a imam. That was the reason why they resorted to this opinion. But the Hanabila said, this is only given to the Imam al-Hayy. From the beginning, you are not allowed to pray behind somebody whose prayer is supposed to be unacceptable, but he has an excuse not to observe some of the arkan of the prayer, unless if this person is the Imam al-Hayy. Do you get that opinion? So let's say Nasruddin is the Imam here in this masjid. Right? Are you the Imam? Who is the Imam?
Ibrahim.
Really? Oh, Ibrahim. Very good name. Where is he? Allah accept you and your Imamat. Let's say if inshallah you will be healthy until you meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let's say Ibrahim has a problem. Allah protect. If you pray with us seated, we pray. Do you get it? Nasruddin came one day, Ibrahim was not around. He is supposed to lead us in the prayer. But he cannot sit. He has a problem. Shall we pray behind him? No. According to his opinion, he is not Imam al-Hayy. We tell him, inshallah, we see you next. When you are appointed to be an Imam, then we can go for that. But as for now, stay behind. We ask somebody to go and do. Who can fit the arkan in the way they are. But Wallahu a'lam, the best opinion is the one that says, we follow the Imam. Get it? As long as we're praying behind the Imam, we just follow the Imam. This is because of the saying of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. قال لأن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم صلى بهم جالسا فصلى قوم وراءه قياما فأشار إليهم أن يجلسوا ثم قال إنما جعل الإمام ليؤتم به فلا تخلفوا عليه فإذا صلى جالسا فصلوا جلوسا أجمعون. In Sahih Bukhari and Muslim, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was praying with the companions and then he prayed seated. So they started praying behind the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم standing. So he indicated to them to sit down, sit. And then after the prayer, he told them, إِنَّمَا جُعِلَ الْإِمَامُ لِيُتَمَّ بِهِ. In another narration that Shaykh Nasiruddin Albani mentioned also in one of his books, he said, it is authentically narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لَقَدْ كِتُمْ أَن تَفْعَلُوا فِعْلَ الْأَعَاجِمِ مَا أَرُوا أَسَائِهِمْ. He said, you're almost going to do the actions of the ajam. Ajams, they are the non-Arab, Arabic speaking people. In those days when they say ajam, they're talking about kuffar. Not just not speaking the Arabic language, no. Those are the kuffar. The Faris, the Persians, and the Rome. Get it? So he said, you're almost going to do what they used to do. Well, they stand, you get it, for their leaders in the sense of respect. The leaders will be seated and they were standing. He said that's wrong. You get it? That kind of respect we don't have. To stand for a person, go and receive him, that's okay. A guest come to welcome him, go and meet him there, it's okay. To stand, to say salam, to shake his hand, it's okay. Because the skillet at the bowls were elderly person come to you and you're lying down, say shake his hand from down and you tell him this is the sunnah. Which sunnah are you following? You get it? And what is wrong is he is coming, you think that you will never respect him until you just stand up, he has to sit down first and then we sit. This is what the Prophet ﷺ denies. You get it? But he comes to you, you go receive him, the Prophet needs to do that. You are seated and he comes, a big person, a skillet added for you to say salam to him while you are standing. Stand up also, meet him standing and you say salam to him like that. You get it? But what is rejected is, you cannot sit until he sits while you are already seated. No, if you are standing, no problem. Let him sit first, that's okay. But you are already seated and then because he comes, then you say, no, let me remain standing first until he sit down, then I sit. The Prophet Allah used to reject this. So in this hadith, the Prophet ﷺ told them, you're about to do that evil act of those people, which is wrong. He said, إِنَّمَا جُعِلَ الْإِمَامُ لِيُتَمَّ بِهِ. The reason why imamah is established and recognized to be an act of worship in Islam so that the prayer will be arranged properly, performed in order, whereby there is somebody to be followed. لِيُتَمَّ بِهِ means to be followed. You have imam so that you follow him. That's a very good principle also. You get it? إِنَّمَا جُعِلَ الْإِمَامُ لِيُتَمَّ بِهِ is very good principle that we have to learn, we have to understand nowadays. Get it? Last time I told you one of the mistakes, the common errors that we find in our masajid is people racing with the imam. So when the imam is going for ruku', you don't start bowing until the imam is completely in the ruku'. You get it? He completed his ruku', then you bow. When he is in the process, he is not raka yet. The Prophet ﷺ said, إِذَا رَكَى فَرْكَوْ. When he performed the ruku', you make ruku' after him. وَإِذَا سَجَدَ فَسْجُدُ When he performed the sujood, you make the sujood after him. So if the imam is going for sujood, and then I was bowing also with the imam, at the same time the imam is going and I'm going, I'm not following the imam. I'm doing racing with the imam. And that's wrong. Jabir ibn Abdullah radiallahu anhu said, we used to pray with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then when he bowed for sujood, we will not make sujood until we see the forehead of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam touching the ground first. And then we start going down. You get it? But sometimes, unfortunately, the imam is making the ma'moom to pray like that. Do you get it? Some of the ma'moom, the imam is forcing them to pray like that. Why is that? Because his prayer is what I call touch and go. Seriously, imam, he just touched the ground as if something is pinching him, then comes up. If you say until he touched the ground and then you go, I'm telling you, before you go, he's in the second sujood. That's why some people, they think, okay, let us also follow him, slowly, slowly. But sometimes it's so disturbing when you pray behind somebody, next to somebody who is like that. Wallahi, sometimes I see some people, the imam is going for ruku, the ma'moom also go, and the imam is too slow in going for the ruku, then the ma'moom will get stuck in the middle. You get, especially when it comes to sujood, he's going, the imam is going, taking his time, and the ma'moom is actually, he began with the imam. And then what will happen? He'll get stuck because he's faster than the imam. So he will reach a position, and his eyes are somehow looking at the imam to see, where is he? Why is all that? And also, if you understand the fact that you cannot finish your prayer before the imam, why do you go before him? Why do you even need to go with him? That's what I don't, if you say we are in hurry, where are you going then? He has to finish it, right? Then you can finish, right? You cannot say salam before him. So why do you rush? إنما جعل الإمام ليؤتم به the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم فلا تختلف عليه Don't be different from the Imam. This one in terms of action. When you do this, you do that. Don't let yourself do something which is contrary to what your Imam is doing. So he sit down, you also sit down. قال فإذا صلى جالسا فصلوا جلوسا أجمعوا If the Imam is praying seated, you sit down and pray with the Imam. Is that clear? قال فإن ابتدأ بهم الصلاة قائما ثم اعتل وجلس أتم خلفه قياما This is another opinion for the Hanabila. They said that was the first thing. If the Imam started praying seated, you pray also seated. But they say if the Imam started the prayer standing and then the problem happens afterward, then you should continue praying behind him, how? Standing. They're trying to apply the last hadith of the Prophet ﷺ that I mentioned, because Aisha radiallahu anha said, قالت لما ثقل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال مر أبا بكر فليصلي بالناس فلما دخل أبو بكر في الصلاة خرج النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فجاء حتى جلس عن يسار أبي بكر فكان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يصلي بالناس جالسا وأبو بكر قائما يقتدي بصلاة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ويقتدي الناس بصلاة أبي بكر متفق عليه فأتموا قياما لابتدائهم قياما So the Hanabila said, the reason why we said if the prayer was initiated while the Imam is standing and then the problem happens afterward, they say in this case, we should pray how? We should complete our prayer normally, standing, not seated. And the evidence is the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, which is narrated by Aisha radiallahu anha. She said when the Prophet ﷺ is very ill, he couldn't come out to pray with the people, he told them, Muru Abu Bakr falisalli bin nas. Command Abu Bakr, ask Abu Bakr to pray with the people. So Abu Bakr started praying, the Prophet ﷺ, he found some ease. So he came out and he met Abu Bakr praying with them. So he sat next to Abu Bakr an yasarihi at the left to be who? The Imam. So Abu Bakr was following the Prophet ﷺ and the people were following Abu Bakr. So they said this shows that the prayer began standing. And the Prophet ﷺ did not tell them sit down, and this is the last issue of the Prophet ﷺ. There are some scholars who believe that if he sits down, you sit. Even in the last minute, the Imam sat down, you go seated. So wallahu alam, as you can see, in terms of evidence, this opinion is very powerful. It's very powerful. And it is in the middle, wallahu alam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us ease. قَالَ فَأَتَمُّوا قِيَامًا لِبْتِدَائِهِمْ قِيَامًا. So they completed the prayer while standing, because that was the nature of the prayer from the beginning. قَالَ وَلَا تَصِحُّ إِمَامَةُ الْمَرْأَةِ. So you got the issue, right? So if the imam cannot perform the rukun, the Hanabila says this is only applicable to the Imam al-Hayy, the Imam al-Ratib. Other than that, we didn't follow that. Do you get it? They're also taken because of the nature of the Prophet ﷺ, since he is the Imam al-Ratib. Do you get it? To be on the safe side, the opinion is very powerful and strong in this regard. And they also say to be moderate, combining or reconciling between the opinions, we should make it like this. If the Imam was not ill at the first part of the prayer, the Ma'mum should continue praying normally. Do you get it? The Imam is the one who will take the excuse and the rukhsah, but the Ma'mum shouldn't take that rukhsah because it doesn't affect him. قَالَ وَلَا تَصِحُّ إِمَامَةُ الْمَرْأَةِ بِالرِّجَالِ. The leadership, the imamah of a woman for brothers is invalid. Did you hear what he says? Okay, alhamdulillah. We had one in the US, right? And I'm told that another one also happened then. Playing with the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the scholars said, they said, لَا تَصِحُّ إِمَامَةُ الْمَرْأَةِ بِالرِّجَالِ. Woman leading man in prayer is what? Wrong. As I told you last time, I don't think if the Imam, how many Muslims you have in Nottingham? Around 1,000. How many you have in the masjid? 2,000. Okay. So what do you think if the muazzin is Karima, and the muazzin is, oh, on Friday Karima is going to give khutbah? Okay, I hope there is no Karima from the sisters. Let's say that Karima is going to be the Imam in Jummah prayer. Like what she did, right? Amina Wadud, may Allah guide her. Right? Do you think there is a Muslim who will not come to the masjid? My Sheikh told me, لَا يَبْقَى فِي الْمَدِينَةِ مُنَافِقٌ. You get it? That's one of our scholars. He says, if the muazzin in the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a woman, there will be no munafiq who will not be praying in the masjid. So I do believe even some non-Muslim also, they will come and join the prayer for a while. Do you get it? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide them. So for wisdom, Sharia says we don't. Honestly speaking, let's be honest to ourselves. How would you pray if instead of Ibrahim, another person is going to, opposite gender? How would you pray? Salah with complete khushu', right? The most khashi'ah salah you're going to have, right? Or your prayer will be completed in the wrong way. For sure, I'm telling you, there is no trust at all. Right? You'll be thinking, woman can pray behind you, and that's okay. But man cannot pray behind a woman, and the prayer will be okay. Do you get it? Am I right or wrong? Okay, I'll give you one example. I passed there, I saw one basketball. I never saw it. I think from day one it is there, right? I thought it's new. Now when I pass, I see the light, I say, oh, Nottingham is developing. Let's say today there is a football or basketball. You get it? Brothers are playing basketball. And Nottingham, you don't have restriction, right? Everyone comes and watch, right? The sisters, they come and watch. Honestly speaking, what are they watching? Game. Thanks. They're watching what? Game. But let's say sisters are going to play. Even table tennis, not even the football or basketball, that's too much. But let's say they're going to play even, what is the easiest?
Chess.
No, I mean the one that you run and come back. And we say, Masjid Nottingham members of the community, they have the opportunity and the privilege to go and watch. Auzubillah, this is just an evil example, right? But let's say you're going to watch. Or people are going to watch. How many people among those brothers will be watching the game? I'm telling you, whoever tells me he's watching the game, I will tell him you are lying to me. And try after the football finish, ask them who won. They never know. Seriously, I mean, if the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he did not let them watch him playing with his wife, right? This is Muhammad and this is Aisha. What? This is Muhammad and this is Aisha. Complete form of hijab and complete form of decency and shyness from both Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the wife. But still he told those excellent people in terms of Iman, you guys move. They say, what happened, Ya Rasulullah? He said, I have something here. I will come and meet you. He said, Aisha, come down. When they left, nobody was watching. And then he said, he told her, come down. She said, Ya Rasulullah, what happened? He said, would you like to do racing? She said, okay, no problem. Let's try. And they try, and in those days she was very skinny. And the Prophet ﷺ was old, so she defeated him very easily. Then the Prophet ﷺ came. He just wanted to give her some happiness since they were walking on the journey since when. Okay, let us give her some ease. Do you get it? But he doesn't let them watch. Later on, afterward, in another journey, the Prophet ﷺ told the companion also, you move forward. I will come and meet you there. It's okay, no problem. And then he told Aisha, come down. She came down, and the Prophet ﷺ ran with her. He said, Aisha, can we do it again? She said, yes. So most likely she told him, if you want to lose again, let's do it. And she forgot, she wasn't the same Aisha before. They did the racing, and the Prophet ﷺ defeated her. When they came back, he said, هَذِهِ بِتِلْكَ عَشَىٰ. This is my revenge. Okay, let us go and catch the people. Salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. You see, he prevented her, right? But when the Habasha, those people from Abyssinia, they came and they were playing with their rumah and all this, next to the masjid, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam let Aisha to watch the game. What was he watching? She was watching the game. But he did not let the companion to watch her running. Nowadays we have some Muslim sisters, right? They come in the early morning or sometimes evening, they ride the bicycles and go around and do the jogging and all this. May Allah guide them. May Allah guide them. So somebody is there watching, right? There has to be and there must be. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide them. So that's the reason why I say praying behind a woman, it doesn't go. How about a person praying behind his wife? Can his wife be his imam? We agree, in this masjid, a woman cannot pray here and we are the mamun. This is not to say the brothers are better, no. You know the wisdom, right? Yeah, they will get lost. Do you get it? This is first Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we go like that. But if we are to understand the wisdom behind that, it is not about this one is better, this one is not better. No, inna akramakum indallahi atqakum. But there is a wisdom behind that. You praying, a woman is in front of you, it doesn't go. Because most likely you will not relax. If you relax, your brother will not relax. If he relax, you might not relax. So we have to do what? Close the door. But this is your wife. Can she be the imam? That's actually a question. Can your wife be your imam?
No.
Why?
Because same attraction is still there.
But this is your wife, يا أخي يوم 24 ساعة تراها. Sometimes you don't want to come back home. You get it? There are some people, right? Yeah. He preferred to stay in his office. Coming back home, he doesn't want to meet that woman, right? They said one of the scholars, after he buried his wife, he looked at her grave and said to her, "Anti Talik, Anti Talik, Anti Talik," and a great scholar. So people were shocked. The student, "This is Sheikh." They said, "Sheikh, what happened?" He said, "No, just leave it." He said, "No, Sheikh, you should have divorced her long ago before she died." He said, "No, because you don't know what kind of life I was living with her. And I pity the miskin that is going to marry her after me. So since I'm used to her for ages, I just accept. But now I'm told by the Sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam that she's going to be my wife in paradise, I don't want her." So this imam, can he pray behind his wife? You have people in this life, right?
Sheikh, if it was permissible, then why did the Prophet pray behind his wife?
No, this is a matter of choice. Even the imam in the masjid, I can just say, "No, I don't want this imam. I go to another masjid next to me, I pray," right? So I can say, "I will not pray behind my wife." And just like the way she will say, also, "I will not pray behind you." That's, it's just okay. I mean, based on rida, can or cannot? We're talking about now halal or haram. Is it permissible to pray? Or are we not talking about, is it sunnah to pray? No, is it even allowed to pray behind a wife? قَالَ أَعِشْ وَلَا تَصِحُّ إِمَامَةُ الْمَرْأَةِ بِالرِّجَالِ. Woman leading male in the prayer is batil. What is the evidence? Okay, I'm coming to you, Saif. The evidence, he said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, لَا تَأُمَّنَّ مْرَأَةٌ رَجُولًا. A woman is not allowed to lead a man in the prayer. This hadith, to my knowledge, and even here also is mentioned, is weak. From every angle you come, this hadith is weak. Do we have any other evidence? Yes. First of all, almost the ijma of the scholars. Second of all, Ummu Haram told the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that I want to lead my people in the prayer. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave him permission to do that. And he appointed, listen to this, he appointed an old man. Somebody said, "I saw that man saqata hajbahu min al-kibr." The eyebrows were gone because of the age. Look at lack of trust. And somebody will tell you nowadays, no problem, they can have shoulder to shoulder in the masjid. Did you see that? We saw that, I saw that in the prayer that she led them in the church in the US. In the masjid, they don't have barrier between male and female. Here's the man, here's the sister, here's the man, here's the sister. Right? So in that masjid, the imam does not need to say sawu sufufakum. Seriously, he doesn't need to say, now you say sawu sufufakum, right? You go with the qiyas people, please strengthen the line, otherwise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In that one, you need to say that? No. Sheikh Abu Ishaq said, come and see them when the imam said sawu sufufakum. He said, everyone was, mashallah. Because here is a woman and here. So legally disobedience to the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A legal disobedience to the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But here the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even the adhan, he did not send a young person to go and make the adhan. He sent who? And the Ummu Haram is not a young sister. It's an old woman. But still the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not send a young person to her. He sent an old man, a very old man. The narrator says, I saw him. And his job is just to make the adhan and leave the place. Is that clear? Even that one also, the muadhin, his job is just to make the adhan and leave the place. The point is to let them have the adhan and then she pray with the people in the house and then leave the place. That's why this is the practice of the companions. There was no case whereby a woman led them in the prayer. There was no case in the time of Tabi'un whereby they let the woman led them in the prayer. And the sisters also are not looking for that actually. Get it? The sisters also are not looking for that. Get it? But nowadays, they're looking for the right. You get it? In this time, within their own aql, they're not looking for that. Because they know the law of Allah SWT does not make it permissible. Is that clear? And then the consensus of all of the scholars was almost going to be established. It's a very weak controversy that you can find on this issue. Otherwise, all of them agreed that a woman shouldn't go in front of the rijal and lead them in the prayer. So the wife, can she pray behind the husband, and can the husband pray behind her? No. Who will be the imam? The husband. Where can she stay if she prays behind the husband? Behind or side by side?
Behind,
right? So she cannot stay side by side because the Prophet ﷺ said they should stay behind in the prayer. We will see that inshallah. Okay, let us take one. وَلَا مَنْ بِهِ سَلَسُ الْبَوْلِ. And likewise, you are not allowed to pray behind somebody who has سَلَسُ الْبَوْلِ. سَلَسُ الْبَوْلِ أَكَرَمَكُمْ اللَّهُ is a person who cannot control the urine. You got it? The person who can't control his urine, praying behind this person, Sheikh said, is also batil. Because he's praying with najasa, right? I don't have any evidence to support this. You get it? And the qaida says, كُلُّ مَنْ صَحَّتْ صَلَاتُهُ لِنَفْسِهِ صَحَّتْ صَلَاتُهُ لِغَيْرِهِ. You get it? If his prayer is okay, praying with other people also is okay. But of course, if we can find somebody who is not having that test, it's better for us to prefer that person over the one who is having this problem. وَالْأُمِّيُّ الَّذِي لَا يُحْسِنُ الْفَاتِحَةَ. Likewise, it is impermissible for you to pray behind an illiterate person that cannot recite Surah Al-Fatiha properly. You get it? A person doesn't know how to read Surah Al-Fatiha because Fatiha is what? Rukun. So if he doesn't know how to read it properly, you shouldn't pray behind him. You get it? But as long as he can pronounce the letters properly, as long as he can pronounce the letters, makharij al-huruf is properly pronounced. But there are some slight mistakes. It's okay when you pray behind him, inshallah. أو يخل بحرف منها إلا بمثله. Or somebody who is not pronouncing properly any letter of the حروف of Al-Fatiha. You have in some places they recite الضاد with را or لام. Do I pray behind him? غير المغروب ولا اللالين. I pray behind somebody else, right? Islamic University, he prays like that. He recites it louder and I heard him saying, Walallaleen. Should I pray behind him? Or if I go with the statement of the Shaykh, what happened? La tasihu. صلاة لا تصح صلاة رجل يصلي خلف شخص يخل بحرف من حروف الفاتحة. Do you get it? So this is a very crucial issue. For the opinion that says Fatiha is rukn, if you pray behind somebody who cannot pronounce the letters of Surah Al-Fatiha properly, then your prayer is gone. Do you get the idea? Unless if he has an excuse. When he has an excuse, then this is a different case. As we said, the general legal maxim says, كل من صحت صلاته لنفسه صحت صلاته لغيره. If your prayer is okay in the eyes of Allah, when you lead another person also your prayer is, it's okay. That's leniency of Sharia. So sometimes we have to divert a little bit the statement of the scholars of fiqh to the ease of the Sharia. They're all trying to reach what pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but sometimes to make it easy to the people, we have to focus more on the nasus of the Sharia. So كل من صح صلاته لنفسه صح صلاته لغيره. Okay, let's just finish this ولا 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 and then we stop. قال ويجوز اتمام المتوضئ بالمتيمم. It is halal and permissible also for you to follow the one who is praying with tayammum if you are mutawaddi'. Do you get it? This is because of the hadith of Amr ibn al-As. In one of the battles when he prays with the people and he was having tayammum but he prays with them and they have no wudu. You get it? He did not make wudu. And he has also to make, he was supposed to make ghusl, he did not perform the ghusl. He prayed with them like that, with the tayammum. They complained to the Prophet ﷺ, and the Prophet ﷺ called him and asked him, why did you do that? He said, Ya Rasulullah, I had janaba that night, and it was extremely cold. I have a strong fear that if I used water, I will die. The Prophet ﷺ just smiled. What does that mean? It was okay. What he did. And they complained because they all had wudu and he has tayammum. Why did he pray with them? And the Prophet sallallahu said, it was okay. That's why he said, if you have wudu and another person has tayammum, it's okay for you to follow him. وَيَسُحْرِ إِمَامُ الْمُفْتَرِدِ بِالْمُتَنَفِّلِ. And it's also okay for you to pray behind somebody who is praying sunnah and you're praying the wajib. You miss the Isha prayer, you come and the people are praying Taraweeh, join them. Is that clear? That's okay. And likewise, also the one who is praying sunnah, he can also pray behind somebody who is praying the wajib. Both can. Do you get it? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when he was in the Masjid al-Khayf in Mina, and after he finished the prayer, he realized that two brothers did not pray with them. فَأَمَرَ بِهِمَا فَجِئَ بِهِمَا. He asked somebody to go and bring them, and they brought them. They were so scared of what will happen. He said, جِئَ بِهِمَا تَرْعُلُ فَرَائِسُهُمَا. Al-Fara'is, this is the meat that is here. How much fear you have when this one keeps on shaking like this. So they brought them and this, the fara'is, this part of their body is moving. The Prophet ﷺ told them, relax. He said, why didn't you pray with us? Aren't you Muslims? They said, Ya Rasulullah, we are Muslim, but we already prayed in our place before we come here. He said, don't do that again. If you pray in your place and you come to the masjid and you find people praying, you should pray with the people, it will become sunnah for you. Their prayer is what? Sunnah. You get it? And the prayer of the Prophet ﷺ is wajib. Okay? Mu'adh ibn Jabal used to pray with the Prophet ﷺ Isha and go and pray with his people, Isha also, and he's the Imam. His prayer, the second Isha, is what? Wajib or Sunnah? Sunnah. And their prayer is wajib, and the Prophet ﷺ approved that. You get it? That's why he said, it is permissible for you to pray behind a person who is praying Sunnah. Again, if you're praying the wajib. Likewise, the one who is praying the wajib, it is permissible for him also to pray behind who is praying, what do you call, the sunnah. So both can. You pray sunnah, you can pray behind somebody who is making a wajib. You pray wajib, you can pray behind somebody who is praying the sunnah. What is the evidence for that? The hadith of Mu'adh ibn Jabal, right? And some other cases that I have mentioned. And also they mention the last evidence here. أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم صلى بطائفة من أصحابه في الخوف ركعتين ثم سلم ثم صلى بالطائفة الأخرى ركعتين أيضا ثم سلم. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم during the one of the battles, he divided the Muslim into two groups. This is how they pray صلاة الخوف. So he prayed with the first group two ركعتين. And then he said, Salam. Finish the prayer completely because this is Qasr, right? So when it's finished and then the second people come, the Prophet ﷺ prayed with them also two rakat and then say the Salam. The second prayer of the Prophet ﷺ was what? Sunnah for sure, because he already prayed the wajib. That's why the best opinion says if you pray with the Imam, the first prayer is the one that is going to be taken. The second one will be Sunnah. Even if the first prayer you don't have khushu in it, but it will be the one that will be taken. You get it? That's why you have to be very, very careful when you pray. Because the first prayer is the one that most likely is going to be recognized by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us in truth. So I stop here, inshallah. If we come, we will begin from the saying of the Mu'allif. وَإِذَا كَانَ الْمَأْمُومُ وَاحِدًا. And next time if I ask, I know I'm going to have a lot of answers. Some people will tell me we already finished the topic. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us success in life. سُبْحَانَكَ اللَّهُمَّ وَبِحَمْدِكَ أَشْهَدُ أَن لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ أَسْتَغْفِرُكَ وَأَتُوبُ إِلَيْكَ. We stop for question and answers, inshallah.